Master.
Blessed is the kingdom of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and through ages of ages.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God entered therein, let us pray to the Lord. For our Father and Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, for the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord. For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord. For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Ronnie, Andrew, Joshua, Connor, Benjamin, Thaddeus, and Adam, let us pray to the Lord. For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those under persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace. Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Lord God.
Let us pray to the Lord.
To Jerusalem, to Antioch, and one of them, named Agabus, stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. And this took place in the days of Claudius. And the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brethren who lived in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul.
Peace be to thee that readeth.
Bestow your blessings upon his family, his parents, whose example of faith and spiritual guidance have directed his desire to serve at thy holy altar. Grant peace and continued well-being. Preserve thy servant uncondemned in all things, so that through service as an acolyte he may continue to glorify thy blessed kingdom, both on earth during liturgy and unto eternity in heaven. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now and ever and unto ages of ages.
We are welcoming Sarah Bloom back to her church here. As Bloom
Louisville continues to grow in population.
Servant of God, Patrick and Church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Seem as important, perhaps, or it's overlooked. It's a blip on the liturgical radar.
and not as many people pay attention to it. But I'd like to suggest a couple of reasons this morning why we should pay attention, both to the fast and to the feast, and why it's worthy of our attention, our participation. The first, regarding the Apostles' fast, is that it is, you know, a recognized fast. It's kind of hard to know that when it's only maybe 2 days long. But like this year, for example, it's 2 weeks, approximately. So, and of course, in the liturgical calendar, we're never asked to just fast arbitrarily. There's always a reason. Even on ordinary Wednesdays and Fridays, there's a reason why we fast on every day. And furthermore, when we encounter an extended fast, whether it's 40 days or 2 weeks, it's an indication usually of the importance of the feast that follows. You know, the more important the feast, we say, the longer and more strenuous the fast. Of course, all of our feasts are important, but some are given extra attention by the church, precisely so that we don't miss them or let them pass by. And, you know, many of the feasts that we celebrate during the year, we fast only for, 6 hours? But for Peter and Paul, we do set aside this time, this recognized period for fasting. And that's because these saints, Peter and Paul, are very important to us. Together, by their preaching and teaching and by their godly example, their very lives, they laid the foundation of the church. You know, it's significant to realize, and I don't know if we often do, or at least often enough, to look back and think, if it hadn't been for, you know, and in this case, if it hadn't been for Peter, Paul, and their work, there would be no church. You know? I mean, that's just the way it is. People would say, well, you know, God could have, you know, but God didn't. God used Peter and Paul. And the church, you know, didn't just float down from heaven intact and suddenly pop open its doors ready for business. It had to be built, if you will. Yes, it's a heavenly institution. It is the body of Christ. It's not the creation of men. But men were involved in founding it. And, you know, of course, in this age of Gnostic Christianity, that's kind of a scandalous thing to say, you know, that men are involved in the works of God. But it's true. It's an absolute fact. Peter, Paul, the other disciples, apostles, laid the foundation of the Holy Church, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord. And they built upon that foundation with living stones, the people that they taught, converted, baptized, and shepherded in the body of Christ. Their work, in a very real sense, was complementary to the Theotokos. Because, you know, she participated in bringing Christ's physical body into this world, and Peter and Paul participated in bringing his spiritual body, the church, into this world. So their contributions are great, tremendous, and, you know, marked by one of the icons that we often display on the feast. So that is, you know, it shows Peter, Paul standing together. You've got to stand close to the mic. Good advice always. They're standing together, holding up a little bottle representing the church, you know, as the pillars, as, you know, and of course they're presenting it. They're both pointing to the church and presenting it to the viewer, the icon. And, you know, in the language of the church, we might say it is meet and right to honor these men who contributed so much through their life to giving us the Church of the Living God. But I'll suggest yet another reason. Besides, you know, as if founding the Church wasn't enough, and you want something else, okay, I'll give you one more reason why we ought to pay attention to the Apostles' fast, besides giving honor to these men. Which, you know, by the way, that's a very important thing too. Honoring those to whom honor is due. One of the great failings of our culture is that we have forgotten how to give honor, and we don't even honor things like marriage or motherhood anymore. You know, so it is, if we are not yet grateful or thankful or know how to give honor, it is certainly part of our redemption that we learn how. And that's one reason why we have these feasts. But we also know that we honor these men, that they were fallen, like the rest of us. That's true. That's unavoidably true. There was, you know, this little matter of the indiscreet falling out, that where else but Antioch, where all good things happen. When Paul publicly accused Peter of hypocrisy, that whole story you can read in Galatians 2 if you want to refresh your memory. But yeah, Peter made a boo-boo, and Paul called him out in front of everybody. Nothing discreet there. Not, hey, you know, I want to talk to you, Peter. And I was just like, boom, in front of everybody. Might as well take that appeal board. And I suppose that it caused a little bit of a rift between these two men. But whatever their feelings on the matter were, it's clear that at some point they were reconciled. You know, and Peter, in one of his later epistles, spoke very well of our dear brother Paul. You know, and there's this other icon, this other major icon that is associated with the feast of Peter and Paul embracing very tenderly, sharing the holy kiss. And even their heads are positioned in such a way that kind of looks like a heart, you know. It's very romantic. It's very romantic. Yeah. But, you know, we don't know if such an event really occurred, but it certainly speaks of great things, you know, an important icon demonstrating the love that even the fallen can have for one another in Christ. You know, even those who struggle here on earth can develop this love of God and this forgiveness, this mercy, this grace. And I think, as I thought it over, you know, in preparing for this homily, I thought, what a great theme for us to adopt for the Apostles' Fast. You know, it seems like Lent obviously has a theme. We're preparing repentance, prayer, fasting, and almsgiving for Pascha. Advent obviously has a theme, you know, again, preparing for Santa Claus. And what about this one? It's like preparing for the Apostles. Well, how about reconciliation? Since that's one major thing they're known for, and the major icon, why not use this period of time to be reconciled, you know, with people in our lives? All of us have relationships that showcase our brokenness in one degree or another. Maybe we resent or hold a grudge against certain people. Maybe we have hurt people or people have hurt us. We might even be angry at people who have been dead for 20 years. I mean, you know, these things happen, right? Wouldn't the fast of the Apostles Peter and Paul be a wonderful time to deal with these kinds of things? If they're known for their Christian love and their reconciliation, wouldn't this sanctified time of fasting be well spent seeking our own reconciliation with others? Why not ask them, Saints Peter and Paul, to intercede for us during this fast, to help us gain the strength to forgive, to seek forgiveness, whatever it is that's necessary, and, you know, be reconciled. Now, we have to point out that in an imperfect world, we can't always be physically reconciled with other people. Maybe because of distance, maybe just because of the nature of the relationship, or maybe because, you know, they're dead. I mean, you know. But there's things that keep us from the face-to-face hugging and such. But still, in our hearts, you know, maybe we've got things we need to let go. Maybe we've got things we just need. Or maybe it's a situation where there's an estrangement and you want it to be good, but it can't be good. But at least, you know, you want to let go of any harm in your heart, any pain, not necessarily the pain, but the anger, whatever, resentment, justification, whatever the case may be. Heal the wounds of our souls with the balm of love, forgiveness. We need help.
And I think Saints Peter and Paul might be the guys to help us during this time, during this fast. To say, you know, I want to be in my heart, if not in person, I want to be right inside. This might be a very good time to pray for people that maybe normally we don't even like to think about. You know, when people tell me, and you got to be careful what you tell your priest. People tell me that they're really mad at somebody or they hate somebody, and you know, the priest is going to make you start praying for them, of course. And that's a hard thing to do. It really is. You know, I mean, it's hard to pray for somebody that you just don't like. But we should. I mean, maybe that's the very reason why we don't like that person. Maybe something. God learned us to pray. And maybe you're the only person that's praying for that poor soul. But whatever the case may be, you know, we need to forgive. We don't need to talk it out with folks. You say, well, I would like to be reconciled, but situation, you know, doesn't allow it, you know. My ex-husband or my ex-wife, you know, whatever. You know, but you don't need to have a sit-down face-to-face. It's like I say about forgiveness vespers. We don't have booths outside, booths of reconciliation. You know, I've actually had people say, well, I can't forgive somebody. You know, I haven't been reconciled, or we haven't talked about it. It's like, what do you need to talk about? You just forgive. There's no prerequisite to forgiveness. We don't need to talk it out. We don't need to air our grievances. We don't need to find justice. We don't need to make the other person see what they've done. You know, we don't need to even have the other person be friendly toward us. If that's the case, we simply need to love them and stop further wounding ourselves by our lack of love. You know, our dear brother Paul once said, if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. I think that's a wonderful thing, you know. It describes the fact that we can't have everything beautiful. It's not all, what's the phrase, rainbows and unicorns. But as much as you can, as much as it's possible, and as much as it depends on you, be at peace, love, forgive. Not everything in this world can be perfect, but as much as you are able, make peace with others, and the God of peace will show his grace upon you and bless you. The glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
May the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
President of the United States and all civil authorities and our armed forces everywhere. The Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
For the Orthodox servants of God, especially for Teresa and Gloria Lynn, for Linda, Drew, Leo, Otto, Julian, Jared, Destiny, Serena, Gary, Nancy, Chaz, for Lori, Christine, Lauren, Michelle, Kelsey, Caitlin, Stephanie, Taylor, Claire, and Christina, that they have mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, pardon, and remission of their sins. The Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
For the Orthodox servants of God departed this life, and especially for Howard, the Lord God remember them in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Our prayer unto the Lord. For the precious gifts now set forth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God entered therein, let us pray to the Lord. Our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, and necessity, let us pray to the
Lord. Have mercy.
Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
That the whole day may be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless, let us ask of the Lord. Peace, a faithful guide, a guardian of our souls and bodies, let us ask of the Lord. Pardon and remission of our sins and transgressions, all things good and profitable for our souls, and for peace in the world, let us ask of the
Lord.
We may complete the remaining time of our life in peace and repentance, for a Christian ending to our life painless, blameless, peaceful, and a good defense before the awesome judgment seat of Christ. Let us ask of the Lord. Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God. Let us love one another, that with one accord we may confess.
Bring us from non-existence into being, and when we had fallen away, his grace is up again, and this time.
to heaven, and hast endowed us with thy kingdom, which is to come. For all these things we give thanks unto thee and thy only begotten Son and thy Holy Spirit. For all things of which we know and which we know not, and for all the benefits bestowed upon us, both manifest and unseen. And we give thanks unto thee also for this ministry which thou hast vouchsafed to receive at our hands, even though there stand beside thee thousands of our angels and the thousands of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six winged many eyes soaring aloft, borne on their pinions, singing the triumphal hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and saying,
oh,
course, be mindful, O Lord, of our Father and Metropolitan Joseph, whom do thou grant unto thy holy churches in peace, safety, honor, health, and length of days, and rightly dividing the word of thy truth. Our great God and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all.
Having commemorated all the saints again and again in peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Gracious, let me send that person.
ministers to our enemies. Neither will I give thee a kiss as to Judas. The light of thee, the light of the best thee. Remember me, O Lord, in thy kingdom. Not into judgment, nor into condemnation. Be my partaking of thy holy mysteries, O Lord, but unto the healing of soul and body.
Fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.
people and bless thine inheritance.
Be the name of the Lord, from this time forth.
come upon you through his grace and love to his mankind, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen.
Glory to thee, O Christ, our God, and our will, glory to thee.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Amen. Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Sessions of his all-immaculate and all-blameless Holy Mother, by the might of the precious and life-giving cross, by the protection of the honorable bodiless powers of heaven, at the supplication of the honorable glorious prophet, forerunner, and Baptist John, of the holy, glorious, and all-honorable apostles, of our Father among the saints, John Chrysostom, Archbishop of Constantinople, whose divine liturgy we have now celebrated, of the holy, glorious, and right victorious martyrs, of our venerable and God-bearing fathers, of Saint Barnabas, the patron and protector of this holy community, of the holy and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of the venerable David of Thessalonica, of John, Bishop of the Goths of Crimea, and of all the saints who of all ages are well pleasing unto thee, and of the saints whose memory celebrate the day, especially Barnabas and Bartholomew. Have mercy upon us and save us, for as much as he is good and loveth mankind. Through the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, our God, have mercy on us and save us.
Blessed feast of our patron, Saint Barnabas. Thank God. From the earliest days of Christianity, the Church has given honor to those who have been glorified, those who have proven themselves, those who have run the race, and they won. And as the Church proceeded from those early days, she took the names of those who were glorified. And the people who came into her Church took the names of the men and the women and the children who are glorified as well, to honor it and to carry that little bit of heaven within themselves. And that is why, as I mentioned last night, we surround ourselves with this great cloud of witnesses, the saints who have been glorified. On our patronal feast day, we remember a special one for our gathering, for our family, and that is St. Barnabas. Some 30 years ago, not everybody realizes that there was a day when we had no name. And with one voice, as we prayed, Barnabas came to mind. Why? Because Barnabas means the son of encouragement. And we had seen ourselves as a place of encouragement. That God through us was, through our weakness, encouraging many people in our Southern California area. And so we took St. Barnabas as our patron. And as we venerate him today, we are reminded in a certain sense, it's like an incredible embrace of peace. We are embracing this relic of our glorified patron saint. And for maybe that brief moment, if you will, we're sharing in that glory. And we're remembering that just as he followed Jesus Christ and gained glory, we, through his prayers, are reminded that we can keep that image alive before us, of glory, eternal glory in the heavenlies, in Jesus Christ. So today, on the feast day of our patron, we share the joy together of this veneration, this beautiful, if you will, embrace of our glorified patron saint.
Thank you. all the good things which thou hast bestowed upon me. For this present and the light of my home life, for their ministry. Wherefore, if they be for our prison, I stand kindly in the protection and the shadow of every transgression to me, if your accomplice in any of the last God's project, thy glory, and the future of your sins. In the life of the last and the hour, the bread of life, the God's holy, and the future of your sins. And the future of your glory, together with the Father and the Holy Spirit, now that we must see eight stages of the end. O thou who willingly dost give thy flesh to me as food, thou who art fire pursuing the unworthy, consume me now in my grave, but rather master all my body parts and swell my joints and my heart. And now, O Lord, with all my transgressions, cleanse my soul and hallow down my thoughts, make her my knees, and my bones wash like white, and my head upon my flesh, thou shalt be holy in thy fear. Thou shalt be guard and keep me from every soul corrupting nation, Lord. Let me purify and show me a warm institution in thy hand, and show me the beauty of thy life, and the light 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 of thy life, and every evil being, and every passionate pleas from fire. As intercessors are raised to thee, all these sanctified, both the leaders of love, and the power of thy foreign, and thy wise apostles. Besides, in time of action, with your mother, do thou receive their prayers in my heart, through our creation, and make my servant to be a child of the light. For thou alone, a good one, our sanctification, and to land of our souls.
Yeah.
divine, both now and ever in the creation of ages. Amen. The church is revealed to all of the living in heaven, to be the faithful in the way of life, standing there and replying about the proclamation of this house of the Lord. Lord have mercy, 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 Lord have mercy. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and at the end of the age. Amen. More honorable than the cherubim, and more glorious than the heavens and the seraphim. Thou who without corruption bearest God, who art naturally the only one who made your flight. Bless the Father, in the name of the Lord.
Hear the prayers of our holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and save us.
Okay.